Welcome everyone. Assalamu alaikum. This is our first lecture on microwave engineering. In this course, we are going to follow up the textbook of microwave engineering by E.M. Huzar. Effectively, this book is equivalent to another book, which is Foundations for Microwave Engineering by R. E. Collin. However, this course is basically based on the textbook of D.M. Huzar. I am Professor Ahmed Atiyah. I am Professor in Microwave Engineering Department at Electronics Research Institute in Cairo, Egypt. If you are interested, contact with me. This is my email. The first point is, what is microwave engineering and why? The field of radio wave frequency and microwave engineering generally covers the behavior of alternating current signal with frequencies in the range of 100 MHz to 1000 GHz, which means from 10 to the power 6 Hz. 10 to the power 12 Hz. This effectively the frequency range of microwave engineering. RF frequency varies from VHF, which is from 30 to 300 MHz, to ultra high frequency UHF, which is from 300 to 3000 MHz or to 3 GHz. And microwave typically used for frequencies between 3 GHz and 300 GHz. These frequencies correspond to wavelengths from around 10 cm to 1 mm. So, the wavelength of such signal is determined as the speed of light, C, over the frequency. So, for frequency 3 GHz, the wavelength would be 3 multiplied by 10 to the power 8 over 3 multiplied by 10 to the power 9 is giga. So the result would be 0.1 meter, which corresponds to 10 centimeters. On the other hand, we are talking about 300 gigahertz, so the wavelength would be 1 millimeter. So from the range of wavelengths 10 centimeters to 1 millimeter, we call this signal as microwave. Specifically for wavelengths less than 1 centimeter, we call this frequency is millimeter waves. So, signals with wavelengths on the order of millimeters are often referred to as millimeter waves. So, effectively, millimeter waves starts from 30 GHz to 300 GHz. This is effectively what we call microwave signals. The question now, why microwave signals represent a separate part of engineering? Because at high frequencies, the wavelength is short. So, standard circuit theory cannot be used directly to be used in microwave networks. Why? Let us assume that we have a very simple circuit. For example, source, resistance and simple wire. But this simple wire has a length which is comparable to the wavelength. So in this case, the voltage and the current on this simple wire is not constant at every point. It varies according to the wavelength. So at a certain point, you can find the voltage is peak positive. And in another point, you will find the voltage is a peak negative. This means that the value of the voltage is not constant across the circuit because the field across the circuit is moving as a wave. The question now, what will be the situation at low frequencies? At low frequencies, this wavelength is very long, such that a circuit, for example, 10 centimeters or even 50 centimeters, is very small fraction of the wavelengths. So if the circuit is very small fraction of the wavelengths, it means that the voltage would not vary across the circuit. So the voltage at the starting point is the same as the voltage at the end point. So at low frequencies, or in other words, at very long wavelengths, the circuit has constant voltage and constant current across all the conductors. This is not the situation at higher frequencies. So, for example, if we are talking about simple circuit like this, and we are solving this circuit at low frequency. In this case, very simply, we say that the potential at this point is the same as the potential at this point. So, this corresponds to short circuit. So, in this case, this point and this point are the same node. And effectively, in this case, this resistance is short circuit by this wire. But in the case of microwave, we cannot do so simple simplifications. Why? Because effectively, the potential difference here and the potential difference here depends on the wavelengths across this wire or this transmission line in this case. So this is not simply, we cannot say that the potential here is the potential here if the length here is comparable to the wavelengths. And because the wavelength in microwave range is very small, is in the order of centimeters or millimeters, so very small parts of the circuit will correspond to a guiding traveling structure, a waveguide for a traveling wave or a standing wave. So, in all cases, the potential is not constant at every part at high frequency. That's why microwave engineering is completely different from traditional electrical circuits. In microwave engineering, the lumped element approximation, such as a resistor, capacitor, inductor, may not be valid. Why? Because if I'm talking about a simple capacitor, for example, the capacitor is assumed to barrel plate, and between the barrel plate we have a dielectric, and effectively the dominant current in this case is the displacement current. But the leads of the capacitor in this case would correspond to series inductance. And if the lead has different lengths, so it will have different inductive effect. So in this case, we cannot get a simple piece and say that this is a capacitor. Effectively, what is a capacitor in low frequency is a complete circuit in RF and microwave circuits. So the concept lumped circuit element approximation is not valid in RF and microwave frequency. We cannot say that this is a resistor, this is a capacitor, this is an inductor. No. On the other hand, microwave components often act as distributed elements. So effectively, a very small transmission line can represent an inductance or capacitance. So for example, in microwave circuits, if you look at this circuit, from the point of view of simple electrical circuit, this is a conductor, and this conductor, there's another conductor here, and they are separated from each other by this small green line. Okay? And there's another conductor, and this conductor is also separated. So, from the simple electrical circuit point of view, this is effectively just some piece of conductor separated by insulator material. So they are open circuit. But from the point of view of microwave engineering, this is distributed element. So, for example, this is stub, this open circuit stub, and this is another open circuit stub, and they are buried to each other, or they are buried to each other, and they have one common port. And for example, this may be equivalent to a capacitive effect, and this corresponds to inductive effect. And here, in between these two lines, there is a capacitive effect, another capacitive effect, or another coupling capacitive effect, which couple the RF signal from this U-shape to the other U-shape. And the other U-shape here is equivalent to LC circuit, for example. And this U-shape is coupled to the other U-shape, and so on. So effectively, this circuit, or this structure, or this configuration, is equivalent to multiple L and C circuits connected in parallel and series connections. You cannot see L and C in this case, but this what we are calling distributed elements. So microwave components often act as distributed elements, where the phase of the voltage or current changes significantly over the physical extent of the device, because the device dimensions are on the order of the electrical wavelengths. So this, the dimensions of these parts are comparable to the wavelengths or the operating wavelengths. So for example, this length, it may be slightly less than lambda by 4, where lambda is the wavelength of the operating frequency. So in this case, it would be capacitive. This U-shape, for example, is slightly greater than lambda by 4. So it would be inductive effect. For example, this U-shape is around lambda, or lambda by 2. So lambda by 2, it would be a series LC circuit in some half. We can see that every part in this case will be equivalent to a circuit element. So that's what we are calling distributed element. On the other hand, at much lower frequencies, the wavelength is large enough that there is insignificant phase variation across the dimension of the component. For example, if you are talking about 10 kHz, if I'm talking about 10 kHz, the wavelength, it would be 3 multiplied by 10 to the power 8 over 10 to the power 3. So it means that one wavelength is 3 multiplied by 10 to the power 5 meters. It is equivalent to 300 kilometers. So to change the voltage from positive to negative, we are talking about a distance 150 kilometers. So it is very long distance. If I'm assuming that I'm talking about a circuit around 50 centimeters, so along this 50 centimeters, the voltage would be constant at 10 kilohertz. But if I'm talking about a wavelength 1 meter, 1 meter, it means that I'm talking about frequency 300 megahertz. At 300 megahertz, the wavelength is 1 meter. So if I have a circuit 50 centimeters, it means that the voltage will move from positive to negative at the ends of the circuit. So that's what we are seeing at much lower frequencies, like 10 kHz, 100 kHz, 1 MHz. All of these are called lower frequencies. The wavelength is large enough that there is insignificant phase variation across the dimension of the component. On the other hand, if I'm talking about the optical signal, in optical signal, the wavelength is much, much smaller than the device itself. So the device is effectively multiple of wavelengths. So the other extreme of the frequency can be identified as optical engineering, in which the wavelength is much shorter than the dimension of the component. In this case, we cannot say that the potential or the difference, the voltage is varying from positive to negative at a certain region because it has multiple variation inside the device. So in this case, we are talking about the rays or the geometrical optics of the problem, not talking about the phase difference between a point and the other. In RF and microwave engineering, then one must often work with Maxwell's equation and their solution, because everything is goes to wave equation or electric and magnetic fields in waveforms. So effectively, microwave engineering is mainly based on solving Maxwell's equation to obtain the electric and magnetic fields. As an example for distributed element circuits in microwave, here we have a simple waveguide. Simple waveguide is very simply, it is a hollow tube from conducting material. Such hollow tube doesn't have inner conductor, it is just a tube. And in such a tube, the electromagnetic wave can travel from one hole to another. And if we are inserting irises, just simple metal sheets like these yellow sheets, we can obtain a filter. So effectively, these irises inside the waveguide correspond to equivalent L and C in traditional circuits. But physically, we don't have a physical conductor or physical capacitor. That's what we are talking distributed elements. Here is the frequency spectrum. If we are talking in terms of the frequency, so around 300 megahertz, the wavelength corresponds to 300 megahertz, the wavelength corresponds to 1 meter. Starting from 1 meter to 1 millimeter, so start from 300 megahertz to 3000 megahertz, we are talking about the microwave range. So starting from wavelengths 1 meter to 1 millimeter, we are talking about microwave. Before microwave, we are talking about RF. And RF is specifically, we are talking about VHF and UHF, very high frequency and ultra high frequency, just before microwave range. And before very high frequency and ultra high frequency, there is short wave radio. And short wave radio is from 10 megahertz, around 10 megahertz to 30 megahertz. And effectively, short wave radio has a significant importance because of the atmosphere propagation properties for short wave radio, which enable short wave radio to be reflected from the higher layers of the ionosphere, so it can pass to very long distances. And at a lower frequencies, in order of sub megahertz, is the amplitude modulated broadcast radio. And below this frequency, in just few kilohertz, there is extremely low frequency, which corresponds to long wave radio. And effectively, long wave radio is very suitable for very large distance, and also suitable for penetrating inside water, for example. So it's suitable for submarine and so on. Effectively, we are going, or we are interested in this course, in the frequency range starting from 300 MHz to 3000 MHz, or starting from wavelengths 1 meter to 1 millimeter. At higher frequencies, we see that the far infrared, and at shorter wavelengths, infrared, then the visible light, and after visible light, there's ultraviolet and X-ray. In the microwave range, this microwave range is divided into subbands. So the band from 1 to 2 gigahertz is defined as L band. The band from 2 to 4 gigahertz is defined as the S band. The band from 4 to 8 gigahertz is defined as the C band. The band from 8 to 12 gigahertz is defined as X band. And the band from 12 to 18 is defined as the Q band. And from 18 to 26 is K band. And 26 to 40 is KA band. And 40 to 60 is U band. And 50 to 75 is V band. 60 to 90 is E band. 75 to 110 is W band. And from 90 to 140 is defined as F band. Effectively, L band has significant importance in radar application. L and S bands are used in radar applications. C band, it was used in satellite communication. Recently, Ku band is more used in satellite communication. In near future, Ka band would be the dominant for satellite communication. Also, Ka band 26 to 40 is used in 5G communication systems. In ultra high frequency, from 300 megahertz to 3 gigahertz, this band is used for mobile communication, for Wi-Fi, for industrial and scientific and medical applications. So a lot of devices are used in this band from 300 megahertz to 3 gigahertz. Very high frequency is from 30 megahertz to 300 megahertz. Effectively, this is used for wireless communication, special wireless communication by police station and petroleum companies. High frequencies from 300 megahertz to 30 megahertz. As I said, this is mainly used for ionospheric communication systems. And medium frequency from 300 kilohertz to 3 megahertz. This is what is used for AM radio or amplitude modulated radio signals. And these are some applications. For example, GSM for mobile communication is usually used at the frequencies from 880 to 915 megahertz and from 925 to 960 megahertz. GPS system is used at 1575.42 megahertz and 1227.6 megahertz. Microwave oven is used at 322.45 gigahertz. Ultra wide band is defined as from 3.1 to 10.6 gigahertz. So this briefly is the definition of the different bands of microwave range and some applications of these bands. Applications of microwave engineering. Effectively, almost 90% of wireless communication around us lies in microwave engineering. So, majority of today's application of RF and microwave technology are wireless. Wireless networking communication system, wireless security systems, radar systems, environment remote sensing and medical system, all of them are based on microwave engineering. Satellite communication is basically used on RF and microwave technology. Satellite can be used to provide cellular voice, video, data, any type of communication. Wireless local network effectively is oriented or it is operating at 2.4 gigahertz, so it is microwave signal, RF microwave signal. Radar systems is another application for RF and microwave application, and effectively it is one of the most important application for RF and microwave engineering. So effectively, almost everything around us wireless or even wired. For example, even the computer themselves, the processor now is working in order of gigahertz. So effectively, the basic concept of microwave circuits can be applied for many parts inside the computer. So effectively, microwave engineering is around us in everywhere.